a lot for inviting me. It's a particular pleasure to speak here because the things I'm going to talk about started here at the Institute 2 years ago. I was here for a semester and walking around the woods, started thinking about them. So let me start with some motivation. So let me give myself a reductive group G over a global field K. And since we are talking about motivation, let's feel free to assume the existence of this hypothetical Langlands group, some extension of the Galois group, or rather the Weyl group of K, whose representations into the L group of G, modulo isomorphism, are supposed to parameterize automorphic forms, representations, excuse me, of G. Well, this, even in the best case scenario, this is not quite true. Here you run into a usual problem with a Langlands program. It has some very simple general ideas, and once you try to make them specific, they get complicated. So it's not representations that these parameters are supposed to parameterize. It's something else, which is called L packets. And here it starts looking a little bit artificial. What are L packets? Actually, L packets are just a byproduct of the trace formula, of the lack of stability in the trace formula. So to understand really what these things parameterize, one needs to talk about the trace formula of G. I'm thinking of the invariant trace formula. So this is a G conjugacy invariant distribution on the adelic points of G. And it is a conjugation invariant distribution, but it is not stably invariant in general. So that's a distinction between conjugacy classes over a field versus conjugacy classes over the algebraic closure. So the trace formula for G has a canonical decomposition. This is the pre-stabilization into the stable trace formula plus other parts which are parameterized by what is called elliptic endoscopic data. But again, I'm stressing that we're still working with the group G, not the stabilized trace formula, not the stable trace formula. So this is still a distribution on the adelic points of G. Now let's go back to our parameters. What do the parameters really parameterize? Well, what they parameterize is the parameters, the L parameters, that is this homomorphisms phi parameterize the decomposition, the spectral decomposition of the stable trace formula into a direct integral of factorizable distributions. And when I say factorizable distributions, I mean Euler products. So you have some kind of spectral expansion of the following form, that the stable trace formula applied to a function is some integral over isomorphism class of parameters of some distribution which is called the stable trace. And this distribution can be written as an Euler product. So what the L group really is, and what the parameters really do, is they parameterize the decomposition of this into factorizable distributions. The other canonical summands of the trace formula also have their own L group. It's just different from that. So each summand here has a certain L group, which I will denote by, G sub E, L. And those also have some decomposition, but in terms of parameters into this L group. Now, in order to get more down to earth, let's leave this hypothetical Langlands group aside, and let's look at one of the most important consequences of this picture. Let's talk about functoriality. So now I will assume that I have a map between L groups. This induces a map between parameters. And therefore, such a map between L groups, naively speaking, is expected to create some kind of transfer between from automorphic representations of G prime to automorphic representations of G. But again, this is too naive, and this is not quite true. It's not a map about, it's not about automorphic representations. It's again about packets. So I should be talking about a functorial lift of packets. But actually, in the cases that we can prove something, it's more precise than that. The case that we can prove something, functoriality is not really about some abstract sets, but about trace formulas. So let's revisit the endoscopy a little bit. So endoscopy is the following observation that if you look at these other pieces of the trace formula for G, they have their own L group. So how about we try to compare them with something else that has this L group? So let's take a group G, which has this L group over there. This is called an endoscopic group. And we can consider the trace formula for G, and more precisely, we can take for GE, and we can take the stable part of this trace formula. And we can hope to compare it with the E part of this formula. And this is actually what happens in the endoscopic comparison of automorphic representations. And why am I saying that this is more than just a transfer of packets? Because this comes with some extra information. So the extra information is the following, that once you, when you have matching functions, which basically means this is some condition which is described geometrically. There's nothing, it has nothing to do with representations a priori. When you have matching functions for this comparison, then the stable trace for each parameter, the stable trace of phi prime, f prime, is equal to the E trace, whatever would show up in a decomposition of this, the E trace of this function f. So these are called character relations. Yes, I have the same parameter because, like I said, the decomposition of the spectrum is described by those parameters. So both trace formulas have the same L group. So the decomposition of the spectrum is described in terms of those parameters. Of course, I'm simplifying. Here, I'm forgetting Arthur parameters. I'm forgetting a lot of things. But what I want to emphasize is that it seems that the reason that some questions become, the answers to some questions, the conjectural answers to some questions look complicated, is that we're not asking the right questions. If you ask a question about automorphic representations, which is natural from the point of view of number theory, you get a very complicated answer. If you ask a question about the spectral decomposition of each piece of the trace formula, you get a very clean answer. And in the end, whatever you prove is in this clean setting, not in the setting of representation by representation. There's other reasons why, one could believe that the trace formula is a more fundamental object than the representations themselves. Let me mention only one of them. Locally, what is a local L packet for G? Well, there is a very nice, it's a set of representations associated again to some parameter, and it has a very nice description, combinatorial description. However, this combinatorial description becomes nice only if you take the union of this packet over what is called the pure inner form of G. A pure inner form is basically an equivalence class of a G torsor, of a principal homogeneous space for G. So these principal homogeneous spaces show up naturally if you think not of the group G itself, but of the quotient of G by G conjugacy as an algebraic stack. So it seems that the setting of the trace formula where you divide G by G conjugacy is the one that gives rise to these pure inner forms that give a nice parameterization of local packets. My reference to the trace formula was really for purpose of motivation. I would like to focus on the relative trace formula now of Jacquet. The relative trace formula in its most general setting is a potential generalization of the invariant trace formula. And how is this a generalization? Well, what is the data here? The data is some homogeneous space for a group G, another homogeneous space for the same group, and the relative trace formula is a G diagonal invariant distribution on the adelic points of this product. I will not explain exactly how you get this distribution. With the word trace, and you're not the only one. Professor Langlands also takes issue with this. But in any case, that's the word that has been that's being used. So it's a G invariant distribution. It's an inner product, really. But the trace is also an inner product. So let's see how you will discover the trace. Well, let's see how you will go back to the trace out of this setting. Well, the first thing to observe is that there is an isomorphism between x1 cross x2 mod g. And actually, let me, for simplicity now, assume, I'll break the symmetry at some point in the future, but let me, for simplicity, assume that the spaces are the same. So let's say that g is a homogeneous space, g mod h. Then you have an isomorphism between x cross x mod g and g mod h mod h. This is an isomorphism in the sense of algebraic geometry, not at the level of rational points. In the special case, so instead of thinking of the relative trace formula as a g invariant distribution here, you may think of the relative trace formula as a h bi-invariant distribution on the adelic points of G. And for most of the part, that's what I'm going to do today. There is a, in the special case when X is a group, and the group acting on it is two copies of itself by left and right multiplication, then you also have an isomorphism of G mod H with H mod H conjugacy. I mean, these isomorphisms are really simple to see, you know, naively at the, if you think naively, namely, what is it here? You have H cross H, you act on the left by H diagonal, you act on the right by H diagonal. You can make sure that on the second copy of H, you get the identity element. And then you still have freedom to act by the stabilizer on the first copy, so you get H mod H conjugacy. So there's it's something very formal and simple. So in this special case, the relative trace formula, the relative trace. Excuse me? Not yet. Not yet. Nothing. So in this special case, of course, in this special case it is. It is, the group is a symmetric space. So in this special case, the relative trace formula specializes to the trace formula for the group H. So like the trace formula, the relative trace formula can have stability problems. So in general, the relative trace formula for X has a stable part plus other parts. These other parts outside of the setting of the usual and the twisted trace formula have not been studied. But under some assumptions on X, so from now on, X will be, let me say, a multiplicity-free space. I don't want to explain this very precisely. It's some spherical variety with some extra properties. Symmetric spaces very frequently. So under some properties, under some assumptions on X, to this stable part, you can attach some L group, which is supposed to say something about the spectrum. So this L group, the dual group for a spherical variety, was first discussed by Gates, Corey, and Nadler. In the setting of the geometric Langlands program. And then in this setting, which has to do with automorphic representations and distinction, it was discussed in my common work with Venkatesh. And this is an attempt to explain things that have been discovered by Jacquet, Prasad, and many other people. So this didn't come out of the blue. It's based on the work of many people. But in any case, there are conjectures which say that this part of the trace formula decomposes into the gross Prasad case. I will mention it in a moment. So the conjecture is that the stable part of the trace formula, the relative trace formula, has a decomposition into factorizable distributions over parameters into this L group, pretty much. I'm cheating a little bit here, but let me not get into too much detail. Now, very often it happens that there is no other part. The trace formula is stable. So for simplicity from now on, let's assume that these things are equal. Okay, so let me explain now what this spectral decomposition really means. What is the actual content of this spectral decomposition? What does it tell you? It tells you something about periods of automorphic forms. So so for simplicity now, I will assume, like I said, that the relative trace formula is the same as its stable part. And I will replace parameters by, there will be no packets. I will replace parameters by representations. Then what is this thing that shows up on the spectral side of the trace formula? I should describe to you some H-bind variant distributions on G. What are these things that show up? Well, here's the definition. J sub pi applied to some test function F is simply an inner product of what I denote by P sub h. P sub h is what? P sub h is the period functional. It is given by the following integral. So suppose that I have an automorphic form f. I will integrate it over adelic mod rational points of h. This is what I call P sub h, is the period functional. So the period functional is an element in the dual of my representation. I can smoothen it a little bit. It comes into my representation, and then I can take inner product. Very explicitly, what I wrote down here, this is just a sum over an orthonormal basis for my representation of the period integral. Let me denote like this the automorphic quotient. The period integral of f times the period integral of f convolved with little f. So the spectral side of the trace form of the relative trace formula includes period integrals like that. Under good assumptions, you expect these period integrals to be factorizable, to be Euler products, to be L functions or special values of L functions very often. So that's what I meant here, that you expect the relative trace formula to decompose into a direct integral of Euler products. So let me give two examples. So the first example will be that of Waldspurger. So G is the group PGL2, for simplicity, PGL2. And H is a non-split torus. And this torus splits over a quadratic extension. So this quadratic extension has some ideal class character associated to it. So then for this, in this setting, so the dual group of G mod H in this setting is just the dual group of G. And the representations that show up, and the these distributions that show up and decompose the relative trace formula do admit an Euler product, as Waldspurger proved. They do admit an Euler product. And almost every factor here of this Euler product is equal to the following unramified L function. People who are familiar with Waldspurger's result may be a little bit confused by the denominator. The denominator shows up there because remember that I'm summing over an orthonormal basis. So I have to count my automorphic forms according to their Petersen inner product, not first Fourier coefficient. So this is the normalization factor that comes in. Yes, I'll get to that. So this is the first example. Now, with the second example, what I would like to do is motivate the talking about the relative trace formula. Why do I think that the relative trace formula is the correct setting in order to put these things? Well, let me remind you the setting of the Gross-Prasad conjectures. So here you have a quadratic space V. And you embed it in W, which is V plus a line. And then your space is S of V cross S of W mod the diagonal of S of V. This is not a symmetric space. This is not a case of symmetric space. However, again, you expect such a decomposition. And there are several fine elements in the conjecture that suggest that the conjecture is not about G and H themselves, but about this double quotient. So the local Gross-Prasad conjecture, which is a theorem by Waldspurger and Waldspurger-Monglen, states the following two things, among others. First of all, in order to get a correct parametrization of local L packets in this case. What does it mean, local L packets for a space? It means the problem that you're trying to solve is which representations appear as functions on X. Or equivalently, which representations admit an H-invariant function. Now, that's the question you're trying to solve. So you group them into packets, and then you say how to parameterize those representations. So without giving too much detail, to get the correct parameterization, you need to include pure inner forms of X, whatever this means. It means some collection of inner forms of G and H. This is well understood if you think of the quotient G mod H mod H instead of just thinking of the space G mod H. If you think of this quotient algebra-geometrically, you get these pure inner forms appearing. Secondly, the local conjecture says that once you do that and you bring all these inner forms together, these L packets are actually singletons. There's only one distinguished element in each packet. Again, the relative trace formula will explain that. Why do you have L packets in the group case? Because the trace formula is not stable. Well, in this case, even if the trace formula for the group is not stable, the relative trace formula for this is stable. There's no distinction between orbits over the algebraic closure and orbits over your field. So that explains why you don't get L packets here. And there's a third global reason why the conjecture of Gross-Passard seems to be. And the global conjecture has been formulated by Chino and Ikeda. If you try to write down this, the spectral decomposition of the relative trace formula as an Euler product, the conjecture says that you can do it. Except that there is some mysterious factor here, which is not Eulerian. It's some power of 2. This little detail suggests a relevance to the trace formula because I lied a little bit before. When I was decomposing the stable trace formula of Arthur, you also had this factor showing up in front. All these little fine details that show that that the conjectures themselves are about the relative trace formula. So in other words, what one would like to do now is to establish some kind of functoriality, not for groups, but for spaces. So since for every relative trace formula, you can associate an L group, the question is, if you have 2 of them, excuse me? Sorry? Yes? Why not? They're not using one, but they have this. They're not. No. The question. No. The L function is hiding in here. Yes? The L function is hiding in here. Here is some power of 2. It's the famous 2 to Watson. Okay. So the L function is in here. Okay, so these are not really products in the convergence sense. These are special values of L functions. So, so suppose that you have 2 different spaces, but suppose that I have the same L groups. Can you prove functoriality between them? If you were able to do that, then one would expect that this would also prove period relations. So this would prove something about this being equal to some L function. That's the goal. I should stress, though, that at no point am I changing the L group of the trace formula. I'm not trying to prove functoriality for a more general map between those two spaces. So these are the questions. Now, can you use the relative trace formula to prove functoriality? Well, yes and no. They didn't use the they didn't use the trace formula. They used the correspondence. The use of the trace formula?
Yeah, the use of U phase.
I don't think, well, Varshuze is the person to ask. I don't think that this conjecture can be attacked with dual pairs. Yes. Yes, but I don't think that the general conjecture can be proved with the theta correspondence. That's what I'm saying. For orthogonal. Yes. No, no, no. He's not saying that. The cases that are proved were proved with dual pairs. Yeah. I don't know how far you can go, but my understanding is that you cannot go to full generality with dual pairs. So having motivated the fact that, having motivated the assumption that the conjecture is really about the trace formulas, it's natural to ask whether you can use trace formulas, whether you can compare trace formulas. By the way, in this Gross-Prasad case that I wrote down, the dual group of the space is the dual group of G. So it's the dual group of S of V cross S of V plus a line. All right. So can you compare trace formulas to prove period relations? Well, in the beginning, the answer is yes, but in the end, it will be no. So of course, you can do it. Jacquet has done it in many cases very successfully. So let's recall now what Jacquet did in order to reprove the formula of Valfrouzet in this setting. So if you have never worked or seen the trace formula before, this is the simplest trace formula that you can ever see. The comparison here is the group is PGL2. And the comparison here is between the relative trace formula for G mod T, where T is the torus, the non-split torus as before, on one hand. And on the other hand, we will have the relative trace formula for G mod A, where A is the non-split, is the split torus, mod A on the other side, where I'm going to put a character. That character, that the only thing that changes is that when I have periods, I'm putting a character here. And the trace formula has a geometric and a spectral side. So you hope to compare geometric sides to get some spectral results. So the geometric side will be a sum over orbits, naively speaking, k orbits. K is our global field of orbital integrals of some function. And here. Other function. So let's try to understand what these spaces of orbital integrals look like. A good approximation to the space of orbital integrals is to consider it as an affine space. So instead of considering orbits point theoretically, set theoretically, let's consider the GIT quotient of G with A. So that is simply given by the invariance. And it turns out that in this case, it's just the affine line. In other words, this is a polynomial ring in one variable. And what is this variable? Well, the matrix A, B, C, D, if we're working with this, with diagonal matrices, the matrix A, B, C, D will go to the parameter C, which is AD over the determinant. This is the only invariant for this quotient. So let's think about this map a little bit. What does this represent? Well, let's see. So I will tell you eventually that almost every point xi corresponds to a unique orbit for A cross A. There are a couple of points which are irregular. The irregular points are xi equals 0 and xi equals 1. Let's look at this and see why. Well, xi equals 1 is the orbit of the of the diagonal torus itself. But this also includes the upper triangular elements, and it also includes the lower triangular elements. So you have three orbits, really. And xi equals 0 is the same thing with anti-diagonal. Outside of these 2 points, this map from G to the quotient is a smooth morphism. Because it is a smooth morphism, when you consider orbital integrals parameterized by a parameter xi, outside of these two bad points, orbital integrals will just be smooth functions. So what I want to do now is to start with a function, a test function on G, and then take its orbital integrals and think of them as being a densely defined function on the base, on the line. So I'll denote the space of these functions that I get this way. And what do they look like? Like I said, I have these two bad points. Outside of those bad points, they will be smooth. They will actually be essentially compactly supported because I start with a compactly supported test function, or I could start with a Schwarz function at the real places, essentially compactly supported. And here I will have some singularities. And what do the singularities look like? Well, let me explain. Close to 0, close to 1, you have the same behavior. So close to 0, if you have two cases, if the character, the local character is trivial, then you get logarithmic terms. And if the local character is non-trivial, then you get C1 plus C2 times this character. By the way, the two cases are not really different. If you think about it, the logarithm is also an eigenfunction for the multiplicative group. It's a generalized eigenfunction. So all I'm saying is that you get generalized eigenfunctions for the multiplicative group. Here you have the trivial character twice. And here you have the trivial character times the character eta. And then you analyze the situation for this quotient. Well, over the algebraic closure, they're the same. So this quotient also happens to have two bad points. And the behavior is the same. What does that show you? It shows you that for every test function f prime here, you have a test function f here, such that the orbital integrals match. What's the last step of the proof of the matching of the geometric sides? Well, the last step is very trivial. Once you have these orbital integrals matching one by one, you can also sum them up together. What looks very trivial here will be very non-trivial in a moment. So they match together. So you have an equality. And this gives an equality of spectral sides. There is a fundamental lemma for the Hecke algebra here. You can separate representations. In the end, you get that the distributions you have here applied to some to matching functions give you equal values. All this way, I'm cheating a little bit because I should put inner forms into the picture. But let's keep things a little bit simple. But let's see what the conclusion is. The conclusion is that these periods which we want to study, a priori we don't know if they're Eulerian, are equal pretty much to those periods. But these periods have been studied by Hecke many decades ago, many decades before Varchuzesso. And we know that these periods here give rise to the L function that unfortunately I erased. So let's go back and write down and keep this L function that we want. We want this L function of pi 1/2, L function of pi tensor eta 1/2, divided by L pi adjoint 1. OK, very good. So we were able to prove something about these periods. And we were able to establish some kind of functoriality between this trace formula and this trace formula. Are we happy? No, we're not happy. Why? Because Jacquet got lucky here. He got lucky because for a specific trace formula that he wanted to study, he was able to find another one which he knew everything about and where the same L functions showed up. This will not be the case in general. For instance, it will not be the case in the orthogonal Gros-Prasad, although it is the case in the unitary gross Prasad, which has been proven by Wei Zhang. So in the orthogonal gross Prasad, at least if you don't want to get in the orthogonal gross Prasad, there seems to be no such matching with periods. And not only that, but also we saw before that there is some very general conjecture about the decomposition of RTFs and some principle of functoriality. We would like to be able to prove this principle of functoriality whenever the L groups match, not only when we have these coincidences that the periods, the values of the periods match. So what to do? Let's try to perform a different comparison. And this is... Yes? Yes, of course. Okay. So for now, I just talked about the unramified factors, really. So Valfouzet has a precise formula, which you can get. Jacquet implicitly did it in another paper, and Wei Zhang discovered it, and then he generalized the method, and he has used this method to prove it for the unitary group in some generality. So you get some local factors that you have to identify. Of course.
It doesn't match the exact functional from
Exactly. It's the local functional that you get from this process is a very indirect one. It tells you that you have a function, you have to replace it by a matching one, and then take something. You have to interpret what this process gives. But Wei Zhang has found a way, based on that paper of Jacquet, to do that. No, it's certainly non-trivial. It's very non-trivial. So let me try something else. Let's try to reprove Valfrouzet. So we're going to work with the relative trace formula for this space, but let's try to work with a different example where the dual group is the same. Let's take the Kuznetsov trace formula. The Kuznetsov trace formula is the one that's associated to the quotient of G by a unipotent subgroup and a generic character on this unipotent subgroup. So these are Whittaker periods, Fourier coefficients for GL2. So can we prove some matching between the relative trace formula for this space, which I will just denote by this, and the relative trace formula for this space? Well, the answer is no, not the way we saw things matching. Why? Because if we could get a matching, we would prove an equality between this and whatever we get here. But here we only get the denominator. So what to do? The first step that you can do is you can use non-standard test functions. Non-standard test functions, I mean, I want to compare the Kuznetsov trace formula with a relative trace formula for the torus. The group is still PGL2. A priori, I cannot do it because I have different L functions.
Remind me, what's the identity that you offer then?
The identity.
On one side, it's close to one sum. On the other side, special values of L functions. What's the identity?
Well, the spectral side of this involves these special values of L functions for this one, the spectral side. It's this integral over representations of these J pi's. I'm trying to reprove the fact that these functionals in the case of Valfrouzet, these periods in the case of Valfrouzet.
But then it's half integral weight, that's
all
right. Sorry? What is the formula you're trying to prove?
I'm trying to prove a formula of this sort, a factorization of these local functionals that include periods over tori into explicit Euler factors. I'm trying to reprove the formula of Valfrouzet for not half integral weight for PGL2, toric periods for PGL2. Well, the other side is something known. The other side is the Kuznetsov trace formula. So it's just Fourier coefficients.
I'm totally confused as to what the identity is.
I'm trying to match this trace formula with this trace formula. I explained before what matching of trace. in both sides, G is PGL2. I haven't changed that. G equals PGL2. However, if you want to write down this trace formula, inner forms will show up on this side. I'm just hiding that. So it's an identity, really, which involves inner forms here. But let's not get into this detail. But in any case, you have no hope of matching these trace formulas with standard test functions. So the first thing that we're going to do is we're going to use non-standard test functions in order to make these required L functions appear here. So let me take a minute to explain what I mean by non-standard test functions. First of all, up to now, I have been talking about test functions as being, Schwarz functions on the adelic points of G. But since we're discussing G mod N, you could also, and in this setting, that's what classically is being done, you could consider Whittaker test functions. Functions on G which vary by this character of N. So these give rise to Poincaré series. And if you choose your, and these Poincaré series are what we're going to feed into the Kuznetsov trace formula. And if we choose our test functions suitably, I don't have time to describe it now, but it's something very classical. If I choose my test function suitably with one parameter n, then on spectral side of the Kuznetsov trace formula, I'm going to get some integral over automorphic representations again, and then sum over L over a basis of pi, actually at a fixed level, and then I'm going to get Fourier coefficients of pi. That's what the spectral side of the Kuznetsov trace formula gives you. Now, what I can do is I can replace this by a non-compactly supported test function. So I can replace, I can define some Dirichlet series in these test functions. This is not the first time this is happening, of course. It has a long history. It happened already with the work of Rudnick's thesis. So basically, what I'm going to do is I'm going to add many Kuznetsov trace formulas together. And this will give rise on the spectral side to the corresponding L function for pi. Now, this is not exactly the L function that I want. I want a different L function. So let me just say that I can use the appropriate Dirichlet series by using appropriate phi, which is not compactly supported anymore. I can get those factors there on the spectral side. Well, that's a little bit of a lie. I have to work with a large parameter s. But I can feed my formula with, I can feed these non-standard functions. This is not a very nice presentation. I mean, I don't want to play explicitly with my functions. So what's a nicer presentation? I need a whole space of test functions. So what I will do is I will describe to you a space of non-standard test functions locally for G mod N psi. How do they look like? So instead of working with PGL2, let me work with SL2 mod N, because it's easier to draw. SL2 mod N is just a fine 2 space without the origin. My standard test functions are compactly supported functions here. Well, not functions, really, because I have this character psi. So really, I have some line bundle defined by this character psi. Now, I can compactify a fine 2 space by adding a P1 at infinity. And the fact is that this line bundle extends to the trivial line bundle at at infinity over P1. So my non-standard test functions will be, roughly speaking, I'm lying a little bit, those that extend, those smooth sections that extend to P1. That gives me not just the unramified factor, but a whole G space of test functions that I can fit into my trace formula. Once I've done it, my trace formulas match spectrally, so I can get hopeful and say, if I didn't know that the spectral side of this trace formula corresponds to this L function, could I prove it by matching the trace formulas? Well, the answer is certainly not. Let's go back to this picture. This picture is how, and I don't want to erase it. This picture tells you how orbital integrals behave for the torus trace formula. How do orbital integrals behave for the Kuznetsov trace formula? Well, here, the quotient of g mod n is again the affine line. It's very easy to see. But I only have one bad point. Let's put it at zero. And it is known that in the neighborhood of this bad point, I don't get this logarithmic or multiplicative behavior. I get what I get certain Clusterman sums. Does anyone know how to draw them? Clusterman. So I get some Clusterman sums. Moreover, having changed my space of test functions, what will happen is that these Clusterman sums will actually, or not out, not these Clusterman sums. In the neighborhood of zero, I have Clusterman sums. Outside of this neighborhood, I just have smooth functions. But they're not compactly supported anymore, because my test functions were not compactly supported. So they will have a certain kind of behavior at infinity. So as you see, the picture of orbital integrals that I get from this and from this is completely different. So it seems hopeless to try to compare these two trace formulas geometrically, if we didn't know that spectrally they match. So what to do? So here's the first theorem. Matching and fundamental lemma for this comparison of trace formulas. It says, remember, these, what I get from orbital integrals are just densely defined functions on the affine line. So the theorem says the following. Consider the transformation G, which is the following thing, iota composed with Fourier, composed with iota, composed with Fourier, where F is Fourier transform, standard Fourier transform on the line, and iota is just a birational map, essentially. Some normalizing factor times F. Iota is just inverting the argument. Then this gives an isomorphism. This gives isomorphism between the space of orbital integrals that you get from the torus trace formula and the space of orbital integrals that you get from the Kuznetsov trace formula by using non-standard sections. Excuse me?
Eta.
This is the quadratic character for the splitting field of the torus.
What's, now let me ask my question again. What is the classical identity you're trying to prove?
I told you the identity is the factorization of periods of torus periods. Is the result of Alfrouzet for PGL2. Whenever you have a relation between trace formulas, you get spectral period relations as well. So,
and what are they?
Well, roughly, I don't want to write down details about what these local factors are. So these are wrote before. These are torus periods squares, squares of torus periods. And this is an Euler product. You can actually describe explicitly the local factors, but at almost every place, they are unramified factors of this form.
What I'm confused about is what's the difference? So you gave Jacquet proof in this way.
Yes. I'm giving a new proof. Yes.
Okay.
I'm giving another proof which is not using the coincidence that I was able to find some different situation with the same L function. This doesn't mean that I'm proving to you that this is a method that will prove Gross-Prasad, right? It's just an effort. It's just an attempt to get a new way of comparing trace formulas, because clearly we don't want to rely on accidents. So this is the statement, the local statement, and it's compatible with the action of the Hecke algebra, with spherical Hecke algebra. Now, for those who are familiar with trace formula comparisons, what I really mean, the spherical Hecke algebra will not be really my distinguished test functions here. My distinguished test function here is the generating function for this L function. So this is the guy that I want to compare to the identity element of the Hecke algebra. And then I can act on the identity element by something. I act on this thing by something. It is compatible with matching. Once you have that, you could say, OK, then I have an equality between the trace formulas. But that's very far from the truth. Why is it very far from the truth? Because unlike before, I'm not telling you that one orbital integral for a test function here is equal to another orbital integral for a test function here. I'm not telling you something like that. Rather, I'm telling you that the orbital integrals of this are related to all orbital integrals of the other by some mysterious transform that looks like that. To prove equality of the trace formulas, you need to show that when you take summation over this affine base, over rational points, this is preserved under this transformation. At first attempt, if you look at it, so what we want, and I'm going to finish in a couple of minutes. So in order to prove an equality of trace formulas, what we want now is to prove some kind of Poisson summation formula for this transformation G. Namely, if I start with a function here, which I get from orbital integrals of the torus trace formula globally now, and I take, roughly speaking, the sum over rational points of f of xi, these are the orbital integrals here. Then I want to prove that this is the same as the sum of g f xi. Now, very naively speaking, this is obviously true. Why? Because look how I define my g. This is the key fact here, right? That this g happened to be a composition of Fourier transforms. Fourier transforms are known to preserve Poisson sums. And this map I, what does this iota do? It just inverts the argument. So essentially, it preserves rational points. Up to what happens with 0 and infinity, it preserves rational points. And then some characters which globally vanish. Naively speaking, Poisson summation holds. In reality, I cannot proceed this way. Why? Because f is a function on the regular points of the affine line. What are the regular points of the affine line? Locally, it's an open dense set. Globally, it's of measure 0 inside of the adels of K. These functions are defined on a meager set. If you remove a point from the adels, you get the idels, for instance, right? These are of measure 0 in the adels. Similarly, if you remove two points, like we had here, you get some very small set. These are not really functions where you can apply the Poisson summation formula. you could say, okay, this function is an Euler product of functions. So maybe what I could do is I could replace it by standard test functions, the characteristic function of the integers, times a finite product. And then take the limit as s goes to infinity. Well, the problem is that even if you try to do that, then again the Poisson sum doesn't make sense because it has logarithmic divergence. Indeed, you're going to want to do that, but the Poisson sum has log divergence. So let me write down just the theorem. Well, this is the theorem, actually. And let me say a tiny word about how it's being proven. Of course, you're going to want to take a limit like this. But you will also want to deform, and this is the key fact, you want to deform the spaces of orbital integrals in a continuous way. What do I mean? Well, we saw here that the spaces of orbital integrals are generalized functions for the multiplicative group. So what you can do is you can deform this to something that looks like C1 plus C2, this character, times a complex power of your parameter, where this is a complex power. So this deformation is possible. It doesn't mean anything in terms of groups, algebraic groups, and trace formulas. But certainly, you can play this game about applying these transforms to these kind of functions and seeing if it works. By doing this, you are able to prove a Poisson summation formula in an, well, I'm hiding some things under the carpet because you really have to deform in two directions. You also have a parameter s here. But in the end, by doing these deformations, you're able to prove this formula. So I'll have to stop here. Thanks.